I will present my recent work in collaboration with Damiano Anselmi and Eugenio Bianchi about prediction of inflation derived from the theory of quantum gravity with purely limited polar quanta. So let's start by giving some details about this. So first of all, purely limited polar quantum, also called Fakon. It has a degree of freedom which can mediate interactions, can circulate inside loops of Feynman diagrams, but cannot appear as a steady state in physical process. Theory of quantum gravity with Feynman in particular has is a quantum theory of gravity. It has it contains a massless spin to field, the graviton, a massless spin zero, the inflaton, and a massive spin to fake. The parameters of the theory are just Planck mass, cosmological constant, the mass of the inflaton, and the mass of the fake. And in particular, for cosmology, all the physical all the physical contents are exhausted by the scalar perturbation and the tensor perturbation, and there are no vector perturbations. So the results of this work collected in this table, we computed the spectral indices and the amplitude for both scalar and tensor perturbation. In this table, we have the results to the leading order. We computed it to the next to the leading order. So in black, there are the Stravinsky predictions. And the red ones are the modification at the leading order from our approach. So you can see that the scalars contribution are not modified, while the tensors are modified by this red factor, which contains the mass of the effect. Yeah. And he is the effect. Besides this, from the consistency of the approach, the Fakon approach in pure spacetime, we obtain also a bound on the mass of the Fakon, which is this one, with respect to the mass of the inflaton. So from this, we can set a range for the possible value of the tensor to scalar ratio R. This one, just to give you some number, if n is equal to 60, you have this allowed interval. And comparing this with the Planck data, we can plot the possible value for R. So here, the red curve is the Stravinsky tensor to scalar ratio in terms of the number of inputs. The blue one is the lower bound, the lowest tensor to scalar ratio set by this bound. And these two number of inputs are the one two from Planck data, extracted from Planck data. So this this area is the possible value for the tensor scalar ratio. So I'm going to give some detail about the derivation of these things and some details about the Fakon approach in pure space. So first, start remembering some property of this theory. We use this action for the computations. We have the Einstein term, the bi square term, and R square term, which triggers inflation. This theory has the degrees of freedom that I told you before, the graviton, the inflaton, and one Fakon. The graviton and the inflaton are quantized with standard methods. The Fakon is quantized with a new prescription that we developed, and then it's projected away from the physical effect. Thanks to this prescription, the theory is unitary and normalizable, and it violates microcausality, but it doesn't violate, it violates causality at small scales, it doesn't violate macrocausality. So, for cosmological perturbation, we did the expansion around the sifter background, as usual, defining these two parameters. We used two different frameworks. We called the first one geometric framework, is the one where everything is in terms of the metric tensor. In this case, because of the presence of the Weisberg term, we have two different de Sitter expansion, because in this framework the mass of the inflaton and the Abel constants are not related. So the mass of the phaeton can be either of the order of h or either of the order of the mass of the inflaton.
So the two possible expansions are
the expansion both in epsilon, but one with this ratio kept fixed between Abel constant and the mass of the phaeton, or mass of the phaeton and the mass of the inflaton. The other framework we use, we call it the inflaton framework, is the one where, as usual, we turn the R square term into a scalar field with a potential, which is the stability one. So I'm not giving all the details in the for the computation in the two framework and stuff like that. Anyway, we did all the computation in both frameworks, and in the first one we also did the computation in both the two possible expansions.
All the results matches once you derive the map that connect the two frameworks.
So let's see how it works. What is the procedure to turn a degree of freedom into a phaeton degrees of freedom in the case of cosmology representation? So a typical action for this case for cosmological representation is this one. So we have this higher derivative term and this function of time. Then with auxiliary field and field definition, we can obtain this action with two fields, U and B. You see that U has the correct sign, so it's a standard degree of freedom. V has the wrong signs, so if you quantize it with standard method, it would be a ghost, and so it has to be turned into a phaeton and then projected away from the physical spectrum.
And this is achieved with this procedure, which is a simplified version of the full phaeton procedure.
So first, solve the equation of motion for B by means of the phaeton green function that I'm going to explain in the next slide. Then insert back the solution in the action, and then quantize the new action, which we call projected action, with standard techniques. So, but remember that the physical variable is still this u, small u, which was a function of u and b, capital u and capital b. So when you want to compute projection function, power spectrum, etc., you have to do it with this variable, which will be a function of u and b, and then v after the projection will be a function of u. So you will get something like this.
But I will go on this later.
So first we need to know what is the phaeton green function. To understand what is this, let's see how the general phaeton prescription works. So this idea of turning ghosts into phaeton comes from high energy physics, in particular scattering amplitude. So in the usual case, so let's consider a one-loop amplitude, A, as a function of P, as a function of the complex variable P. If you study the analytic structure of this function, this is a one-loop amplitude, for example, two-point function. Usually you get a structure like that, so you have branch point and branch cuts. And when you have branch cuts in complex function, you need a prescription to uniquely define this function on the graph. The usual prescription adopted is the one that defines the function on the graph by means of its analytic continuation from above the graph. If you do so, the graph will be associated to production of particles, and this is what you have in standard particle physics. In the case of the phaeton, you don't want to produce that particle because you want to project it away, and if you produce it, we'll have some bad behavior. So our past work was to develop the right prescription to do this, and this is very simple in the end in terms of the amplitude. So it's to define the amplitude of phaeton above the cut, on the cut, by means of this, we call it average continuation. It's just the arithmetic average of the analytic continuation from above and the analytic continuation from below.
if you use this partition for some degrees of freedom, you can project away, remove that degree of freedom from the physical spectrum without violating unitarity, and by keeping its contribution in renormalization at the same time. So this is what we want to do. This is exactly what we want to do in the case of quantum gravity. So now we don't need all of this. In the case of cosmological perturbation, we don't need to, at least for the purpose we had for this paper, we just need to compute three-level correlation function. So we don't need, so since it's three-level and there are no loops, we can just apply the average directly on the green function of the vacuum. And so this turns into this choice for the green function, which is just the average of the advanced and the retarded one. So just to be clear what I mean then with the first step of the procedure that I showed before, to solve the equation of motion of the Fagan field in terms of the green function. Fagan green function means, suppose that the Fagan has an equation of motion of this form, then you have to invert this operator. The inverse is not unique, but in this case it's fixed from the restriction. So you solve the equation of motion, V then is this convolution. Then you have to put it back to the equation. This is basically what happens for the cosmological perturbation. And this is enough to compute everything we compute. However, this procedure, as I said, comes from high energy physics, so is expanding flat space time. So that procedure, having the green function to be the average between the retarded and the advanced one, is the result in flat space time. So we have to understand what to do in the case of cosmological space time. So flat space time, we have to solve almost always an equation of this type, where A is a constant. The result for the Fagan prescription has this form. In the case of cosmological space time, instead, we have to solve something similar to this one, but now A, this thing, is a function of time. In all the cases for all the cosmological perturbation was enough to solve this type of equation in the sitter. And this is just an example. I took it from the case of tensor perturbation. If you do scalars or whatever, it just changes n key, I think. So we have to find the right prescription for this, but we don't know. But what we know is how it is the prescription in flat space time. And there are two non-trivial cases where this equation, this solution has to be the flat space time one. One case is the conformal ultraviolet, where in conformal time you have flat space time. And the other one is the superhorizon limit, where in cosmological time you have flat space time. So if you just impose that the general solution of this equation has to be this one in one of these two cases, just one is enough to fix all the coefficient, and the other one is just a consistency check that we did, and it works. So the solution is this, where J is the Bessel function. So now we have the secondary function, so we can do the simplified fake procedure that I showed you. And so let's go back to the action and how to obtain the projected action. So after the change of variables, we have this action. V is the favor, so we have to solve it with that green function. You get a new action, which is the projected action, which is just a function of U only, counter U, because it's this thing. And now V is this convolution with U. So now you end up with an action, which is now only a function of U, but in general it's non-local. And so you have to find a way to handle these non-localities. The non-localities come from this convolution. However, thanks to the sitter expansion, we were able to handle this. for all the computations by using this
fact.
So this sigma, which is, if you want, the coupling between U and V, which is the one that gives the null of the term, in the sister expansion is always of order epsilon. If sigma is always of order epsilon, then V is also of order epsilon, because V is this thing. And so the null of the term is of higher order. So when we do the computation in the sitter, sigma is zero, and there's no null of the term reduction. When we are doing the expansion, at least at the order where we stopped, the null local term was of higher order. So using this property, if you want, we were able to turn this action by changing the variables again into the Munkan form. And after that, you can quantize everything with the standard method. You find the mode function, you find the power spectrum, etc. However, remember that, as I said before, the physical variable is this small u in all the cases where just a linear combination of capital U and capital V. Now V is solved with this, so in the end the non-locality enters anyway in the computation of the power spectrum because you want the U power spectrum. And so from this W, this is the Mukarov variable, then you go back with all the field definitions. So capital U is a function of the Mukarov variable, and then V is a function of U, and then small u is a function of capital U. So the last thing that deserves some comments was the consistency condition that I mentioned before. This is obtained from the bound that I mentioned before is obtained from a consistency condition, which means which we derive in this way. So the Fekir curvature functions are always of this form, where this function m is an effective mass that the Fekir has because of the cosmological background. And this procedure of the Fekir doesn't work in the case of tachyon. So we can turn a particle into a phaeton, we can turn a ghost into a phaeton, we cannot turn a tachyon into a phaeton. So imposing this in flat space-time fixes the signs in front of y square and in front of r square. Fixing this also in this case, so also here these effective masses to be the square masses to be positive. And fixing this in the superhorizon limit gives you this condition where n key that goes inside the Fermi-Green function has to be real. You can see that it has to be real also from the Green function. So the limit of that Green function with the Bessel function in the flat, in the superhorizon limit goes to this sign. So if n key is imaginary, then this sign is an hyperbolic one, and then it will explode somewhere in time. And so this condition and to be real, and key to be real is this bound. So imposing this condition in every equation of motion for every phaeton that we have to project away, scalar, degrees of freedom, tensor, perturbation, and so on, all of them gives the same bound, which is this one. So m, mass of the phaeton must be bigger than the mass of the phaeton over 4. And so this was the bound that I used before. So now that I gave some details, let me repeat the results. So in the case of tensor perturbation, we did the combination up to the epsilon squared in the sister expansion in the geometric framework, the one with where you have only the metric, and up to the epsilon order in the inflow framework. In the case of the sky, we did in both cases up to epsilon order. And there are no vector perturbation because they're all with the wrong signs, so they all have to be quantized as table and then projected away. So this is just repeating the table. This, as I told you before, is the same table as before. This is the leading order, so it's in quasi the sitter. then you have the other correction that I write here in terms of the number of the equals, in particular for the the correction of this order, correction of the scalar amplitudes are not modified by the Fekl mass, so that this does not contain the Fekl mass, so it's the same correction as in Stravinsky at this order. Higher order will contain the mass. While the tensor one contains the mass of the Fekl at the leading order and in the direction. So, for example, with n equals 60, the first correction to the tensor amplitude is between 0.3 and 2.5%.
Let me repeat again also the
ratio. So, from that bump of the mass of the Fekl, you can extract from Planck data the number of people, then you put it in this. Inequalities, and then you get this plot again. So the number that we used was n extracted from the Planck data from the number of for the spectral index of scalar perturbation. Okay,
that's it.
So concluding. This paper, we computed this spectral index and amplitude, so tensor scalar perturbations. These predictions are derived from a theory, which is a quantum theory of reality, is renormalizable and unitary, thanks to this description that we developed. This theory has only four parameters, one is Newton, one is the cosmological constant, we know the value of those. The other two are the mass of the inflatement and the mass of the Fekl, which now, thanks to this, this computation that we did, they are related to each other with Planck data. And so, when more cosmological data will be available, these two masses will be fixed, and then all the other predictions will be tests for this theory. And some future perspective on this line could be to do higher order computations, or study this theory on different background, or study other phases of the evolution of the universe, or maybe something that you can test. Okay, that's it.
So what can be measured? Go back to the prediction page. So R, how much R can be very much different, right, from Stravinsky?
This is Stravinsky.
Yeah.
So it can be okay. This bound is given by this when m chi is equal to m phi over 4, and this bound is given when m chi is infinity, so when the theory is Stravinsky.
So order of magnitude is smaller.
Yes, this is with numbers, with n equals 60, for example. So 3 over 1000 is Stravinsky, and this is the other bound. So this window for R.
How do you compute the variables in a usual way?
These ones, we use this. From Planck.
No, I mean when you show the formula for the German.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is what? This is in function of the number of people.
Yes, how do you get them?
You can write everything in terms of the number of people.
How?
You relate epsilon with the number of people. And age with the number.
So you use
so you can write the results when you compute them in the Sitter expansion are in terms of epsilon and age. Both can be written in terms of the number.
But which epsilon is the potential of
the Hubble?
This tensor will they be measured?
This I don't know. Some people told me between 5 and 10 years, but I don't know.
More than,
right? Still it's fine. So I don't know. Maybe you can tell me what is the smallest. What is the easier thing to measure?
Is easier? Will it be easier that you measure this or this?
Yeah, exactly.
So once it's enough one. So, because this one we know, this one we know, from one of the two U extract N, from the other U extract mass of the inflaton, and from a third one which involves the mass of the phaeton, we can extract the mass of the phaeton. Which, by the way, the leading order R and NT are also, as in the case of single field extension, R is minus A and NT, at leading order.
Marco, can you show me again the action in the inflaton framework in question? Okay, so the mass of the function is basically the coupling of
the mechanics. Yes. It's like with the star of Easter, you have the mass of the inflaton here, and in this case, the mass.